Yes, so good morning. first of all, I would like to thank Christian Micheletti and other organizers for giving me the chance to give a talk at this meeting in ICTP. So my talk is going to be about unknotting and decatenation in biological system, namely freshly replicated DNA, which still contains nicks and gaps, and also generation of supercoiling started. At the beginning, I would like also to mention something about the place where I work and about the people with who I work. So currently I work at the group of DNA chromosome modeling group at the University in Lausanne in the Center of Integrative Genomics, which is a part of the Faculty of Medicine and Biology. Quite recently we became also a part of Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics, which provides the ground for people studying biological problems by computer modeling. So the head of the group is Andrzej Stasiak. We work together on the DNA topology and molecular biology and topological problems, such as DNA knots. Well, there are two permanent members of the group, Fabrizio Benedetti and Julien Dorier. There is also one ex-member from Department of Theoretical Physics from Polytechnic School in Lausanne. So these people co-authored this work, which is going to be presented. So I would like to introduce you into the talk with this outline. So first of all, I will mention the importance or the occurrence of the knots and links in the biological systems. Then I would like to address further aspects of topological aspects such as topological isomerases, juxtaposition, nicks and gaps, and supercoiling. Then I would like to present the computational model of our DNA with some detail because I want to show how do we simulate these topological aspects, supercoiling and active swivels and so on. Then I will show some simulations going from the simplest cases of supercoil open trifold knot, which is basically a linear chain. Now I will continue through some more complex problems, and finally I will present our biological and computational model for unknotting and decatenation. And I would conclude the talk with some remarks from this talk. Okay, so as we have seen during this workshop, so the knots occur on DNA molecules. They are inevitable, or formation of knots is unavoidable in long DNA molecules and the crowded environments of long DNA molecules, such as is bacterial DNAs. They are a result of the action of topological isomerases, which mediate passages between DNA chains. The DNA knots can be also a result of replication, so as it has been shown in this work by Lynn Zichidrich and all. So, these knots can be very harmful because they can create an obstacle for the polymerase, and they can simply cause the polymerase to stall, and so they avoid the transcription, or they can really cause, upon tightening of the knot, the mechanical breakage of the DNA. So these DNA knots can be very harmful, and they have to be removed as quickly as possible from the molecules. Catenase is another topologically restrained formation of DNA. They are even more regular than DNA knots. They actually, in circular DNAs, they occur always. This is a natural result of the replication, because during replication, there is this object is formed, it's called replicon, and during the replication, the DNA has to be unwound and read by polymerases and ligases and so on. And during unwinding the DNA, substantial amounts of supercoiling is generated. And because this is a closed object, this is circular DNA, so this supercoiling cannot just diffuse away, but it has to be removed by topoisomerases such as topo 4 or a gyrase. But the thing is that in the terminal stages of this replication, there is not enough space for those topoisomerases to sit on the molecules, so they flow away. And as a result of those remaining stirs of the DNA, those two new freshly replicated DNA rings remain catenated or linked or entangled. And also these catenates can be very harmful for the metabolism of the cell, and they have to be removed as quickly as possible. So the cell has these small, relatively small molecules of enzyme, which the cell uses to manage the topology of the DNA. There are basically two types of topoisomerases, which are divided in type 1 and type 2 based on how many strands they are allowed to pass. So intuitively, type 1 will allow topoisomerases, will allow passages or deal with passages of one or single strand, and topo 2 will allow passages of this kind of two strands at once, causing, for example, transformation between relaxed and unrelaxed DNA, supercoil DNA, and knotting, unknotting decatenation. So in this talk, we will be mainly interested in topo 3, and which is type 1 topoisomerase, and about gyrase, which is type 2 topoisomerase. Okay, so the long-standing question is that how these topoisomerases actually know where to act, where should they take the action, because they are relatively small molecules, and in this crowded environment of DNA molecules, it can be rather fuzzy and to say where should it make a passage, and if it acted randomly, it would make the problem, or it would make the system even more tangled, even more knotted. So, well, in the work by Ribenko, Volokotsky, Cozzarelli, and so on, they suggested that there is something smart about the action, behind the action of topoisomerases, and they have shown that, well, they in their experiment, they use linear chains of DNA, and they ligated their ends in a solution, and it produced some equilibrium value of concentration of knots. And then they have seen that when they added topoisomerases, these experiments were made in bacteria as well as human cells. So they have shown that the concentration of knots dropped under its equilibrium limits. So this action of topoisomerases is not random. This is what they concluded. Furthermore, what these authors did on topoisomerases or discovered. So they suggested that for an optimal, for the passage, there has to be created a juxtaposition which consists of a strongly bent G segment and a stretched T segment, which, and for the topoisomerase to successfully act, this T segment must be passing from this convex side, from this bent side to the G segment. And this could also explain, or this could be, this could provide a little, some solution for how this topoisomerase know where to act, because in small DNA molecules, there is a natural curvature of the molecule, so there is a natural bend from inside, so the molecule or the enzyme knows where is the outside, where is the inside. But the problem was, again, in the long DNAs, because this juxtaposition should occur in as a part of some very large crowded molecule. So it wouldn't, again, if it would make a passage, it would cause the molecule to get more knotted. So there was some missing factor into this. And in the work by Guillaume Wietz, Giovanni Dittler, and Andrei Stasiak, it was suggested that when they observed these supercoil molecules in Giovanni's lab, and so Guillaume Wietz did Monte Carlo simulation, and they found that there was a stable configuration which looked like this. It was a stretch molecule, and the knot was localized by the supercoiling in one of those apexes of the molecules. And again, this conformation or this localization of the knot caused that there was this natural curvature of the DNA occurring, which gave an information what was inside, what was outside of the molecule. So there it created this conveniently this bent region for the topoisomerase to sit. Okay, so now I'm going to say again what is about something about supercoiling. So this is the picture which has been shown several times. It's a DNA double helix, and supercoiling is a property which directly arises from this double helical structure of the DNA. Unlike simple polymers, the DNA cannot freely axially rotate because there are double strands, so it's axially, the rotation is axially restrained. In simple polymers, however, we know this rotational coordinate which passes through its potential wells and peaks periodically. But in DNA, the rotational coordinate would look like this. When upon twisting of DNA, the energy will build up and it will be stored in the chain. And so it can be modeled by this physical, like a rubber band. And again, schematically, so we have the case of a circular DNA or rubber band. And now we are interrupted in one place, but it is still connected. And we twist it and we introduce the twist. So this is something like active swivel. And when the torsional stress increases, and it eventually causes the supercoiling or making this of these crossings, it's called a writhe. Of course, in the case of DNA, we talk about delta twist and delta writhe because it has some interesting writhe which originates from this double helical structure. So, and so the molecule releases this torsional stress by this transformation into this additional level of coiling. Now, in biological systems, the role of the active swivel is taken by the topo two, the type 2 isomerase called gyrase. Gyrase is a special topoisomerase which mediates passages of the molecule itself, and it creates a strong band, and it makes the passage in a close environment of this topoisomerase. So it introduces this kind of twist. Okay, so this is the part before I show the simulation. So I would like to go also in some detail into the model. So as it has been mentioned already, I think by Peter Birnau, so we know the structure of the DNA very well. But starting with simulating the DNA from atoms, it would be very time-consuming. It would be very expensive for computational time if we wanted to study the processes on the scale of biological problems. So there would be, moreover, for one turn of DNA, there would be like 600 atoms. So for our plasmid, which would be 3,000 kilobase pair, we would have about 18,000 atoms. And moreover, we would like to study the DNA in its natural environment. So it means at least water or something, some water solution. So there would be like other zillions of solvent molecules. So this would be really expensive for computational time. Moreover, there is a wide span of typical timescales of molecular movements. If we started from atomistic simulations, the fastest movement would be bond vibration, which would start at femtosecond scale. Then we would go through angle bendings on picoseconds, torsional transitions on nanoseconds, through reptations on microseconds, slowly moving to these biologically interesting scales, which would be in fractions of seconds. And of course, in the crowded environments and condensed system concentrated solutions, it could get even up to years. So, in fact, if we started from with atomistic model, it would be very convenient to build a model, to throw everything into simulator, push the button, and see what would happen. So, but this would be wasting of computational time, and actually, as comparison to this fastest atomistic movement, we would produce a lot of redundant information. We would have mostly hydrogen bond vibrations. So what we do is called a systematic coarse graining approach. So we replace some chemical details of the DNA in favor of gaining these faster computations. And the systematic, the word systematic suggests that we don't do it just like ad hoc, but we have some system to it. So here we define our bead, which we use to replace some portion of DNA. The size of the bead, of course, is defined by the scale of the problem that we want to study. So if we want to study problems on the scale of the DNA chain, so we have to use this. This is common in our models in literature, so we use a base pair replaced by a sphere of 2.5 nanometers. Then we would like also to have the classical model of DNA also contains this chain stiffness, which we know is about 50 nanometers. So when our bit is 2.5, so this should be around 20 bits. But actually we had to decrease this value a bit because we introduce also electrostatic charge, which comes from the phosphate groups in the structure of the DNA. Of course, this one is screened, so we could decrease the value of the charge, and we use the bihookal interaction to model it. And then we adjusted a little bit this parameter of bending parameter and this chain stiffness. Now, this would be the beaded chain, but this still wouldn't store the information about the torsion, about the twisting. So we have to add additional beads, which are placed out of chain position or periaxially. And we bind them together by a dihedral potential in this cis position. So any displacement or any displacement of those, any twisting of those will cause an energy penalty. So, and actually the force constant for this interaction determines the torsional stiffness of molecule. And we know from the experimental data what should be the value. Now, this construction was very convenient to use also to create a model for our active swivel or the gyrase. In this case, we continuously varied the angle or the period in this interaction. So this introduced, this acted on the other periaxial particles. And also this was a model for our gapped region. There, in the gapped region, we suppose that there is, it is a segment of DNA where the transcription was not completed, and the gap was this. There is only a single-stranded DNA, so this region bends much more. There is lower bending stiffness, and there is also this. It's like simple polymer, so it can axially rotate. So we interrupt this interaction. So this is once again about the gyrase motor. So these are our real beads, what we see in black here. Here we have these virtual particles, basically vectors, or the particles which don't have excluded volume and so on. So, but they still have some rotational drag. And so this is how we create motor. This is the equation of motor, and the speed of motor was calibrated on biological data, which was about 5 rotations per second. Okay, then there are still those immense number of solvent molecules, which we treated by replacing them with an integral parameter, which was gamma or drag coefficient. And we used this Langevin equation, this Langevin dynamics. Well, the because we wanted to simulate this supercoiling and so on. So for our model, it was also important to have the coefficient of rotational diffusion. So we added to these periaxial particles this gamma coefficient as well, and we calibrated them with experimental data by playing with those, the length of those arms and values of those gammas, so we got to the experimental values. Of course, in the living cell, the viscosity can be much higher because there are a lot of crowders, a lot of organelles, and so on. So this environment in the cell can be very viscous. So it was important to have a grip on this interaction as well. Okay, so in this way, this is the simulation that Lindsay Hidrich didn't show. So, and this is to show that how efficiently we can scale up to really tens or hundreds of on the scale and going up to our biologically interesting data. So now I'm coming to the simulations. So this is the simplest case. It's an open chain or linear chain, but we made a knot in there or crossing, and we localized it. We just pulled the knot by simulation to have it here. We put a gyrase. Now we indicate also the initial position or the position of those periaxial bits which store the information about the twist. And now we'll start the simulation. Okay. And we see that the gyrus starts swiveling, it introduces this twist, it transforms it to right. And this eventually pushes, it creates a gradient towards the open ends of this system, and it pushes all the entanglements out from this system. So, once again, so we can see that really this action of this gyrase can help it to, or can direct those entanglements to go. Now, we would like to see the situation in topological knot or closed knot. So, what we did, so we need to have a closed molecule, but which is allowed to release the supercoil and axially rotate. This is in biology the situation of nicked DNA. So in the place of the nick, one of the strands is just interrupted, and this is the situation of the simple polymer again, which is able to rotate. So now we have again this very simple trefoil knot, and we have here the position of gyrase, and this is the position of the nick. And we start simulating, so we introduce the supercoiling by active swiveling by our gyrase, and we see that all the entanglements are all the way around, so that they are taken towards those nicked region where the supercoiling is released, and they are directed by the gradient of the supercoiling, which was shown. So this was again another situation where we wanted to see what would happen in the case that gyrase and the nick are placed asymmetrically or randomly on the molecule. So again, we started with the structure of which was generated by Monte Carlo. Of course, the molecule was not supercoiled, so it's really a coiled structure. Now we started the simulations, and we see that after some time of struggling and so on, again, the entanglements were pushed towards the nick. Now we wanted to see also what happens in more complex knots. This is the knot with 8 crossings, which was not observed biologically. But this is actually the advantage of the computer simulation, that once we have a working model, we can try a hypothesis and see what would happen or predict. So, okay, so here we have this very complex knot. And again, we see that upon swiveling, the supercoiling is introduced and all those entanglements are pushed, are localized around the nick. Perhaps once again. Now, What would happen once those entanglements are localized in one place? So as I said, we have in biology we have this closed molecule which can axially rotate. It's called a nick, but in our case we will consider another case, which are gaps, and gaps are parts of molecule where the replication was or transcription was not finished, and there are spaces which were not filled. These are so-called Okazaki fragments, and there we have only single strain DNA, so it bends a lot in this place. It has lower bending stiffness. And so we put this into our model, and we can see that when those crossings are localized and in the position of this nicked part, which is actually, or where is a single-stranded DNA, where it can release the twist, supercoiling. So, and when all those entanglements are pushed towards this place, and they create a convenient position for bent region, this G segment, which wraps around the DNA chain because of its lowered stiffness. So, and as for the topoisomerase, now there have been works by Sol and Newman who created artificially such system where they had this gapped DNA and they attached it to magnetic tweezers and they added topoisomerase 3 and they twisted it and they saw that there was a release and there were passages mediated by this topo 3. And there were also other works which already suggested that there could be some long-distance action or interplay between gyrase and topo 3. So at this point, our model was complete. So we had this molecule, our DNA, double-stranded DNA, which was able to keep the information on the twist. Then we had our active swivel. We put there also the gap, and also we consider the action of topoisomerase. And so our modeling process was at the end, and we put this into our simulator, and we run the simulation. So, and this was the case of unknotting. So this was the knot with the gapped region, with the gyrase introducing supracoiling, pushing all the entanglements towards the gapped region, and eventually it made a passage. Now we wanted to see also the catenated system because in the catenates are created always. So as I said, they are somehow more interesting. So again, we had this system of molecules which could be supercoiled with active swivels, with gapped region. In this gapped region, we removed excluded volume interaction, but we kept still the electrostatics. So there has to be some work done to make the passage. And this work is done somehow by this pushing by the supercoil. Here we go. Now both are disentangled. Okay, so these are the conclusions. So we propose the model where topo 3 plays an important role for unknotting a decatenation. Somehow a takeaway message is that in our mechanism, we have the place where the decatenation will occur. This is the nick, and then the topo comes there, and topoisomerase will wait there till the entanglement comes, and then it makes the passage. So it's not the topoisomerase who seeks or for the place where it should act. Okay, so I would like to thank for your attention. I would like to bring to your attention also the work. So the first work is basically what was presented here. And the second work, it's by Rick, and who will present tomorrow. And so it deals with the case when those Okazaki fragments disappeared. They were already filled, so and the top of four has to take action. And then there is another work which we did on in a crowded environment of supercoil molecules, so it can be also interesting. So, thank you.